Hi friends, welcome to Pictures and Paintings. This is Sivaraman. In this video, I am going to walk you through how I painted this severe maca. I have been painting on 300 GSM papers, which was pretty good in holding water for the wet on wet technique. I was a little curious to see what happens with a 200 GSM paper. I wanted to see if my technique holds good on paper with lesser thickness. So out of curiosity, I painted this painting on a 200 GSM paper. Also, the lighting on the reference was pretty flat, meaning the bird was well lit from both the sides. I wanted to also experiment if I can add a little contrast to the lighting in the original one. So I tried keeping the keeping one half of the bird a little bit more brighter than the other. Please let me know in the comment what you feel about the lighting that I have attempted in this bird.
During the sketching stages, particularly after taping the paper, I did not find any difference between sketching on a 200 GSM or on a 300 GSM paper. My sketching process was fairly similar to how I have been doing it. Started off with a very rough sketch, and then once the shape was coming out, I started penciling all the details that I might probably need to add in my painting. First of all, people who are new to painting might be wondering what this GSM means. GSM stands for grams per square meter. In layman terms, the thickness of the paper. Just to put things in perspective, the regular paper that we use in printer is typically a 70 or a 75 GSM. That is not ideal at all for doing watercolor painting. So what you are seeing here is at least 2 to 3 times thicker than a regular printer paper. And the ones that I have been using so far is like 4 to 5 times thicker than the printer paper. Now let's see how this paper holds for my painting techniques. As usual, I started this painting from the face. I was a little nervous at the start, not sure how the paper would react, but the beak and eyes were fairly straightforward. It was more of a wet paint on dry paper. Even the consistency of the wet paint was still thick. One thing I was conscious while painting the eyes was to make sure I don't make any mistakes in leaving the lighter portion of the eyes, knowing that it would be tough for me to go in and do multiple layers. So try to get the eyes painted in one go. Feathers in the face was also pretty straightforward. I did a faint base wash on the face and then painted the small little feathers on the face with a more darker value of the paint. Once that was done, I moved on to the region immediately around the face. I used the combination of burnt sienna and burnt umber for the browns, and then I bent back to the beak to add the worn out texture. So here I was adding details on top of the base wash, and it was holding well. So far so good. I did not face much of a challenge, and now comes the real test, the body feathers. And since this entire painting was to test the paper's ability to cope up with the wet on wet technique, so I decided not to compromise any further and decided to do the green feathers as I would do in any of my other paintings. Wet on wet technique is nothing but applying wet paints on wet paper. Normally I don't soak my paper with too much water. It will be moderate, and that's exactly what I followed here. But I could see the moment I add a layer of water, I could see the paper soaking and becoming wavy. But I went ahead and continued my painting. But other than that, I did not see much of a difference in the way in which the colors were blending. So once the base pass was done, for the subsequent passes on top, normally I don't go with too much of diluted paint. So it started becoming easier and easier when the second, third layers were the paints were less diluted, and I was targeting to paint the shadow regions, the the gaps between the feathers, and that was all coming well. Once the shadows were painted, the painting was also coming to life. I could see the bird progress in the direction in which I wanted, and I also felt I was pretty much in control with the entire painting. So I continued to paint all the details, and this is also the time where I was becoming more conscious about focus on the lighting on the bird. So the subsequent layers of detail which I added were predominantly on the left hand side of the bird than the right hand side. I was also using a more darker shade of the paints for my second and third pass. I have used sap green with a touch of yellow for the lighter shade and emerald green for the darker shade. It really worked out well for me. Once the feathers were shaded dark in the left hand side, I added a subtle tint of darkness in the white region of the face too. At this stage, I could see the lighting come out compared to the reference where it was very evenly lit. In the painting, I could see that there is a clear indication of the direction from where the light is coming. So at this stage, I wanted to pause the bird and move to the background. This is the place where I faced the maximum challenge. The moment I added a good amount of water, we could really see the paper not holding up as much as a 300 GSM paper would hold. So I realized I cannot do the entire background in one go. So I did a first pass of brown shade and then allowed it to dry. And while the background was drying up, I wanted to add a little bit more saturation on the bird. So I went in and did one more wash of saturated colors on the bird's shadow region. By this time, the background had dried up. So I went in and started adding my green tone on the brown background. I pushed the limits, added a good wet layer of green tone, and then sprinkled a few drops of water to see how the water disperses and forms bloom. While the paper was getting soaked and wavy, it did form the kind of blooms which I was looking for. At this stage, I was almost done with the painting. So the final step for me was to go bold and add a little bit more shadow details on the white portion of the face. I went in and did that. That's it. I was done. So my big takeaway from this painting is, if you just look at the end result, in a 200 GSM paper, I was able to get the kind of look which I have got in my other paintings on thicker papers. But the process itself was at times a little challenging. I think if you are predominantly going to be using a more drier technique, like a wet on dry or dry on dry, I think a 200 GSM paper would work out. But if the watercolor painting is going to involve a lot of washes with water, then I think better to go for 300 GSM or even beyond that. Anyway, it was just fun trying this out. And I'm sure in the future also, I am going to be doing a few on 200 GSM. I will keep you guys posted. Please subscribe. Let's stay connected.
And finally, one interesting fact about this. This picture was not part of what I wanted to be painting in this particular series. But I have a collection of references which I downloaded from internet in a folder, and every time I go through that folder, this particular photograph always was taking my attention. So I decided to do this one. Hope it grabs your attention too. Thank you for watching this. See you soon in the next one. Until then, bye bye.